Welcome to the Great American Collectibles Show, heard Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. Eastern on PSAcard.com and the PSA Facebook page. The Great American Collectibles Show is brought to you by PSA and the National Sports Collectors Convention. Tonight's headlines brought to you by Sports Collectors Daily. For all of your hobby news, features, and more, visit SportsCollectorsDaily.com. And now, your hosts, Tom Zappala and Rico Petroselli.
Oh, jeez, I thought you got rid of that.
Wait, he didn't give us a signal yet.
All right, Mark, see, already Rico's bitching.
That's right.
Because he hates the opening music, and I refuse, I repeat.
What'd you tell me? That he changed it?
I said the opening.
Changed the music too.
No. That's.
All right. That's 1927.
No, that's what's us. You don't like the bubble gum?
That's us, man. That's what we're all about. Are you kidding me?
This is you're all about. I'm all about.
I open this up by saying hi, gang.
Hi, neighbors.
And then I want to shout out to my good friend.
How do you know he's your good
friend? Staten Island Joe Marino.
Oh, Joe, yeah.
He's Joe. Your Yankees down 2-1. And they got rained out today, so that means Greinke, Verlander, and who's the guy? What's his name? The guy that pitched last night.
Cole.
They're coming back. Bing, bing, bing. Bye-bye, Yankees.
Tell you what, the Yankees got a chance to win both games at home.
Oh, you know something? Why are you throwing?
I'm not going by liking or not liking a team. Okay, I'm just going by what I see. Here's the players out there. Take the uniforms off, and I'm looking at the talent and all that.
Yeah. I'm throwing this out.
No.
You think Greinke stinks?
I didn't say he stinks. I think he's vulnerable, and I think
Verlander is.
Verlander could be. Yeah, he gives up a lot of home runs. And even though he's on 5 days rest, he still he gives you pitches to hit. I'm not saying he's not going to. You know,
Rico is right. Rico's never right. Wait a second. Who do the Yankees have? They have no one. They have no starting pitching. They stink.
No, they have decent pitching.
Yeah, really. Who? Don Lawson?
No, Whitey Ford.
Whitey?
No.
What, are you kidding me?
No, I'm just. It's not over yet. Right.
I got to read the headlines. I got to do trivia. But let's bring in Taube right now, John Taube.
Hey, John.
Our good friend from JT Sports, because he is a Yankee freak. And I just, before I read the headlines, I wanted to convey my condolences to him. John, my condolences.
You see, John, he's cocky.
You guys are murder. First of all, when I listen to the opening music, I feel like I'm walking in a carnival in Oklahoma.
Thank you very much.
You know, I don't know what that is.
It's
up at the stadium.
Wait a second. That's vintage, classic, pre-war, vintage baseball music.
Like you.
Plus, I had a couple of martinis one night, and it was on YouTube, and I kind of liked it.
Oh, jeez. No wonder. Oh, my goodness.
All right, listen, before we get into Mr. Taube and talk to the rest of our good fellows and Frank and all this stuff, our headlines, T206, yes. Honus Wagner, PSA 2, sets a new record of $1.35 million in the Mile High auction. The latest example of the most famous baseball card in the world sold for $1,353,625 in the Mile High Card Company's latest auction. The same PSA 2 example had sold privately for $1.2 million less than a year ago. It had sold twice at auction, twice before, for $657,000 through Leland's and $776,000 in 2016 via Heritage. It's the second Wagner sale in the last few weeks. An authentic example with trimmed borders netted $540,000 last month.
And he went to great schools.
I did that.
You know what I mean?
Awesome.
I can't read.
Awesome. I have a lisp. Mile High dubbed their auction the event because of the number of iconic cards being offered, but the key card that sold was the great Honus Wagner card. For more info, please go to our good friends at SportsCollectorsDaily.com, Rich Miller and the gang there. What?
Two?
To what?
Two.
To what?
you know.
What the hell are you talking
about? It's a mint two? A mint two?
Yeah, it was a mint two. It was a PSA two, yeah. But it's a mint two. Yeah, but it's a Wagner.
I know it's a Wagner, it's a I'm just, jeez, what has it got on there?
Toby, what would a Petrocelli PSA two
go
for?
All right, so don't be a wise guy now. Don't answer that, John.
What?
Please don't. No.
All right, listen, before we
By
go.
By the way, I got a Ted Williams.
Oh, Joe, I want to talk about that because this is the first I'm hearing about this.
About what? About what I have.
Yeah, but I want to talk. Yeah. All right, but before, listen, for our trivia, last week, at the last minute, by the way, Buddha, you're supposed to know this stuff. You are supposed to know this stuff because at the last minute before the show ended, we had a winner on last week's trivia question.
No, don't tell me.
Had a nurse not prevented
this week.
I am, and then I have a new trivia question. Had a nurse not prevented this player from losing his leg by convincing doctors to try a new medicine called penicillin after being injured in World War II, he never would have gone on to a 10-year major league career.
Who Bill was Vec.
That's awful. That is awful.
Bill Vec had a wooden leg.
This guy saved his leg because he had penicillin.
Oh, he saved it. Oh.
All right, the answer was...
Bill Vec used to have an ashtray in his leg. In his wooden leg.
The answer is Maury Martin. And Stan the Man Orr wins again. This freaking guy wins every week.
Hey, Stan.
Stan is
you got
great.
A life here, buddy? What's going on?
So, Stan Orr, you get it. We'll get it out to you. Now, here's this week's trivia question. This is kind of a cool question, Buddha. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, here's what you're going to win.
Oh, boy. Is that the one you use?
I have
Let's
one
dig it
more.
Out of the satchel.
No.
I thought it was a satchel. I said that thing's used.
It's his man's purse.
I have one more. This is the last one we have.
Ooh. Nice.
This is the last score. 40 cards, 2019 NFL trading cards. This is the last one we have.
Are you sure you're not stiffing last week's winner?
No. I have two. This was given to us by our good friends at Panini. And here is the trivia question. And do me a favor, Stan, you're out. You are not allowed.
Stan.
Yeah, typically there's like a 30-day rule.
Stan was the only smart guy in the whole bunch. So.
Oh, we know that.
Not that we have dumb followers, but some of them are pretty
that's
dumb.
Right.
All right, here's the question. You ready?
Yeah.
This player... And, John, if you know it, you're not eligible. This player got Rico to drink an exotic tropical fruit drink before games in order to give him more power.
Huh?
A.K.A. Serrano. This player got Rico to drink an exotic tropical drink before games in order to supposedly give him more power.
Where did you hear this?
You liar. You are such a liar.
I never drank it. The only thing I drank was a cup of coffee.
Yeah, you're such a liar.
In between doubleheaders.
So who was this player?
Coffee.
Who was this player? This player got Rico to drink an exotic tropical drink before games in order to give him more power. Very similar to Serrano.
It's
very similar to Serrano. You guess it, you win it. How's that? Someone says Gronk. All right, let's get to our friend John Toby. John, right out of the gate, Mr. Petrocelli just informed me that... Why don't you tell him what you have?
I have a Ted Williams signed bat. They're legit.
A gamer?
Yeah, game bat. My game... What do you mean game bat?
Is
What's
it,
the difference?
Game news.
No.
Did he give it to you, Rico?
Not exactly. Boy, it's got to be game use.
Wait a second. Where did you get the bat?
I'll take batting practice now. I'll go hit somewhere.
Where did you get the bat?
I got it from Ted
Williams. Did you get it out of the house, Rico?
No, I got it in the house. It's Ted Williams. Ted Williams gave it to me.
Okay. All right, so Ted gave you a game use signed bat.
No, it wasn't exactly game use.
Okay.
You're
the expert. Would you please explain to Mr. Petrocelli what the difference is between a signed game use? But it was his personal bat, so it's not a store bought bat either,
no.
John. So it's kind of like a tweener.
No.
What did he have? A box of mint bats next to his locker, Rico?
No.
He's digging.
Before we go any further, I'll take $15,000.
What kind of a tell? Seriously, what kind of a bat?
It was a Ted Williams W215.
Okay.
Signed bat, and
late career.
Yeah, I mean, after his career. I mean, what I say, late in career. I didn't say that. Boomba.
No, was he?
Buddha, take that out.
No, was he? Was it? Was it?
No, it was honestly, it's a beautiful bat. I wouldn't sell it for less than 20 anyway.
No, but what is? Give us the background on the bat.
The bat is Ted Williams' bat.
Yeah.
All right. He signed it in spring training years ago.
Okay, so it was his personal bat, not his store bought.
No, not one of these made up. I don't know. They're from the Cape Cod.
Right. All right. So, John, what's the a bat like that? What's the value?
The magic word in Rico's description was after.
Well, I didn't mean that.
Was he in a wheelchair when he gave you the bat?
No, he wasn't.
What year was it?
Listen,
What year? Honestly.
19...
A golf cart out of the...
66.
So he had retired.
It had to be when Rico was playing.
Right, so he had retired, but...
He came to spring training every year.
So he would have his own bats for fungos and hitting ground balls.
Right, but not only that, that's right. No, not fungos.
I'm looking at his records here. He got the W215 model all throughout the 60s right up, into the early 70s.
Yes, that's right.
While he was in spring training.
So does a bat like that, John, have value?
It does. It's Ted Williams. It's one of his bats. Is it numbered, Rico? Did he put 9 on it?
No.
Did you sign it?
Just Ted Williams, though.
He didn't personalize it to you like to Rico?
No. He didn't.
It's autographed by him?
Yes, yeah.
Well, that in itself, I mean, when Ted, in his later years, when he was signing, I mean, it was at least $5,000.
Yeah, not enough.
Try to get a signature on a game bat.
You know, I don't think I would sell it, honestly.
No, but that's not the
point. I give it to my kids. But you know those other bats that are signed? He signed a ton of them through his son, okay?
Yeah.
We use those, for charity. Auctions, golf tournaments, they have auctions and all that. And they used to get about $2,500.
Yeah,
$2,500. Yeah, that was those. They weren't W215s.
No.
They were Rawlings or somebody or the Adirondack.
Before we continue,
that bat's probably worth retail today, probably $3,500
for $4,500
in there.
Yeah, that's cool. Nice. It's nice.
Listen, before we continue on with John, we do have a winner, and thank God, I believe, thank God, it's not Stan or Eddie Fisher. Now, is this the Eddie Fisher that was married to Connie Stevens?
No, to Elizabeth Taylor.
But wasn't he married to Carney Stevens too?
No.
Elizabeth Taylor.
No, I don't know.
If it's the same Eddie Fisher.
I think he was. Right. No, he was a singer.
Fisher is the winner. This player got Rico to
pitcher
drink.
Pitcher too, Eddie Fisher, remember? With California.
Oh, that's
Indians.
Right. Wasn't he a knuckleballer? This player got Rico to drink an exotic tropical drink before games in order to give him more power. Kind of like Serrano. Who was it, Rico? Who was the guy?
Orlando Cepeda.
Orlando Cepeda.
Orlando used to...
So what was in the drink? All kidding aside.
Seriously. Yeah.
Cepeda.
Huh?
Cepeda.
Orlando Cepeda. Yeah. What do you
mango.
Call it? Right. Especially mango. Mango and his other tropical fruits. And he put it in and he'd be singing and going. Yeah. I said, what's that? They said, man, you feel good. You feel good. Make sure you hit. Okay. Can I have some? Hey, yeah, go ahead. That's it. I struck out 4 times that night.
Wait a second. Eddie Fisher. This isn't the same Eddie Fisher. Eddie, are you the same Eddie Fisher that's the pitcher? Because someone said yes, but what the hell does that mean, yes? Are you him or not him? If you are, let us know. Could be. Anyway, all right, so, John, just the last couple of days we've had I got an interesting call. He did tell me we could discuss it a little bit. Maybe you can give us a little background. I got a call from a very prominent auctioneer up here in the Boston area, and he had an estate sale. I guess I shouldn't mention whose estate it was, but it's someone very prominent, a politician. And the only reason I'm not going to, because the bat has not been authenticated yet, but it was a game-used Ted Williams signed bat, and he sold it for either $25,000 or $30,000. Now,
very nice.
So my question to you, John, is Rico has had a bat given to him from Ted, not a gamer, and in the late 60s. I'm assuming this particular bat was a gamer, maybe possibly at the height of his career for that kind of money?
Well, I believe, you know, I had a little bit of wind on this bat. We received a couple calls in the office here with questions about it. And I know it's, I believe it's a W166 that was used by him in the 50s. It's definitely, you know, one of his game bats. It's got great use. You know, it sounded like it was pretty nice. And I can see, you know, I can see a bat like that, you know, garnering that kind of bidding.
John, I don't remember Ted using pine tar. I mean, was there, do you know?
He used? If you talk to, you know, Johnny Orlando.
Yeah, yep.
And Johnny Orlando Jr.
Is that Vinny Orlando's son?
No, brother.
Brother, okay.
He preferred a mixture of olive oil and rosin.
Wow.
Yep, and he would have...
Could have eaten that.
Could have eaten the bat.
Yeah. No, that, I didn't know that. Jeez, that's interesting.
Did you use a lot of pine tar?
I used pine tar, yeah. I used to like it.
Yeah?
Yeah. It was smell
good.
Yeah,
but if you look at images of Ted, especially in the 50s, you'll see him with some pretty nasty-looking bats.
Yeah, huh?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I mean, but John, that... I mean, for a player like Ted, or for a player like DiMaggio or Root, the more pine tar... the better value with the bat, or is that just, it is what it is?
Well, with Ted, no. With Ted, people like them, yeah, if they're full of pine tar, those types of bats are going to, you know, yield the, you know, the most money at auction. You put a 9 on the knob, and you have one that's loaded up with pine tar, and that one's going to, you know, really go to the ceiling.
Yeah.
So why didn't you say something to him when he gave you the bat?
What? What was I going to say to
him? Ted, write your number here and put some pine tar.
No, he never did. I don't remember him doing it at all.
Yeah.
Well, I could have if I would have known. But
how many ground balls did Ted Williams hit you in your career?
Let's see. He hit mostly the outfielders.
He did?
Fly balls, yeah. Yeah, he would have them run from, let's say he was hitting them to left, they were in left field.
Yeah.
He'd have them run towards center field. They were going to catch it on the fly.
Hit and it he like could, right out of their reach?
Yeah, right out of their reach. It's unbelievable. It was incredible. Everybody would just look at him and say, I can't believe it. Wow. And he'd laugh and he says, okay, this one for a Cadillac now. Let's see you get it. Boom.
Just out of their
reach. Just out of reach.
So who would hit you guys? Pesky?
Yeah, the coaches. The coaches did.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, mostly the coaches. But Ted was great when he came to spring training.
Was he a screamer?
Wonderful. Yeah, he was loud. I always thought he had three lungs. I mean, the guy was so loud, and he wouldn't be ashamed to swear in front of ladies, too.
Really?
Yeah, it was tough.
We are chatting with John Taube, the owner and of JT Sports, but Mr. Taube is the number one bat expert in the country.
I know that.
Probably in the world, John. John, probably, right? There's no, like...
Well, you have to preface that with I'm also the only.
Well, I mean, there's no, like, German bat experts out there.
No.
I mean, there's no, like, Yugoslavian bat experts.
Right? But they're talking about it.
Right?
John.
I guess they authenticate cricket.
Yeah.
Hey, by the way, Rico, the gentleman that won, his name is Eddie Fisher, played college ball with your nephew or your cousin, Anthony.
Anthony, yeah.
Anthony Petroselli.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, was he any good?
Anthony?
Yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't bad.
Give me that look like he wasn't that good.
No, listen, he was good, but, you know, he was not in major leagues.
He didn't have your genes.
No. Anyway, I wanted to ask John, what are the hot... See what he does? You know what I mean?
I'm sorry.
Say, look, hey, sorry. Buddha's
yelling at
Buddha,
us.
See what I got to go through?
All right, I'm sorry.
That's why I come every other week. Okay. But the hot bats, current players, John, anybody, especially in the World Series...
The bats that are sizzling right now.
Sizzling?
Sizzling. They're sizzling. Hot off. I mean, you can't keep them if you have them. Ronald Acuna Jr.
Yep.
How about? Okay. You look. It's all these. You know, the young guys with the bright future.
Kit Soto or something.
Barrow Jr. Bo Bichette.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah.
But John, do these guys? I mean, times have changed. Don't these guys control the distribution of bats and their bats?
Not all, but many do, yes.
I thought the team does. Did.
Well, you know, some of the players, the team may have an outlet. You know, they may take some, but a lot of the players, you know, they will. They'll keep their own equipment.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You're right.
Really?
Sure.
So, let's say an Acuna gamer signed, Pinta, the whole nine yards. What kind of money are we talking?
Well, these bats, and right now you have to add photo matched in there because
right.
that's the big authentication procedure right now. But I would say, you know, just depending on who has it and what the bat can be attributed to, if it's a home run or something significant, anywhere from, you know, a low of, you know, 2,500 for a guy like that up to 7,500.
Man.
Mm-hmm. What about
even higher if you get into, you know, rookie or a grand slam or...
Well, I was thinking of Hendricks, you know, he won the MVP of the
season. Elrod?
No, what's his name? Hendricks?
Jimmy.
See, Toby gets it.
You too,
he
John.
He gets it. He gets it. Toby gets it.
I didn't think
it.
You'd go there. Jimmy, cricket. Oh, boy. Buddha, help me out of here.
He gets it.
I can't edit that.
All right. No, the kid that won the MVP with Washington. He hits the grand slam. I think he knocked in 9 runs. And he's an older player. And, you know, he gets that. Is his bat, could it be worth anything, you know, significant?
Oh, sure, sure.
I don't mean,
now, who are we talking about, though?
Hendricks.
Hendricks.
Who's Hendricks? I know, that's not his name. It's, put it up for grabs.
Hendricks. Who's Hendricks?
Hendricks? Jimi Hendricks.
I'm asking seriously. Yeah. You have no clue, do you?
No. All I know, I'm sitting here in a purple haze.
Oh, Howie Kendrick. Jimi Hendricks.
No, like you knew. Both of you guys didn't
He's
know.
He's talking about Howie Kendrick. Thank you,
Hendrick.
Michael. Michael Usaki, thank you. He's talking about Howie
Mike,
Kendrick.
Mike, I thank you. All right, thank you.
Howie Kendrick is, you know, it's not an expensive bat, and
no.
I think even if you can lend it to... You know, that big game, you know, that may be, maybe you have a big, you know, a Nationals fan, and they'll pay maybe $2,500.
Mm. Oh, so that's still not bad.
For something. Well, for that's probably the pinnacle moment of his career, right?
Oh, absolutely.
All right, so what about a common, a Staten Island Joe Marinos, and he's, I know, I mean, he's serious. He's got a bat signed by Greg Jeffries. Is there any value at all to a bat signed by a common?
Unfortunately, no.
Really? I mean, a couple $100?
Greg Jeffries, you know, he had, you know, all the potential.
Yeah.
And, you know, highly regarded player when he came up, but he really didn't pan out.
Right.
So that's a very inexpensive bat today.
Really? Interesting.
Yeah.
All right, we are chatting with our good friend John Toby from Jimi Hendricks from JT Sports. We're going to take a quick break. We come back. We got a whole lot of stuff to talk about with John. Hang in there. We'll be right back.
My name is Davis. Please consider making a donation to the Jimmy Fund and Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and help stamp out cancer in kids. We have all been touched by cancer, but we can win the battle. Please make your donation, and remember, no amount is too small. The Jimmy Fund is the official charity of the Boston Red Sox. Thanks very much.
Hi, I'm Rico Petrocelli. I hope you listen to my pal Davis and make a contribution. We want to make children's cancer a thing of the past, and with your help, we can do it. Just go to TomZappolaMedia.com to make your charitable donation.
This is my fight song. Take back my life song.
Since 1996, Brian Drent and the staff at Denver's Mile High Card Company have led the charge in the collectibles hobby. Mile High is a full-service dealer specializing in buying and selling cards and offers a competitive consignment program for all collectors. Whether it be their computerized want list service, appraisals, or auction services, Mile High has it all. If you've been searching for a company with a selection of high-grade vintage 1888 to 1970 baseball cards and memorabilia that shares your passion, aim high, Mile High. Go to milehighcardco.com or call 303-840-2784 for more information.
This is Brian Drent, president of Mile High Card Company. Is your sports card and memorabilia collection properly insured? For easily replaced personal property, homeowners insurance is all most people need. But for prized possessions that you may have spent a lifetime collecting, it doesn't go nearly far enough. Collectibles Insurance Services has been insuring for over 50 years. They offer a full range of protection and a $0 deductible at an affordable rate with no appraisals required. I know because they insure my collection. If you have a minute, go to collectinsure.com and learn more about insuring your personal card or memorabilia collection.
Would you like to own the bat that was used by your favorite player when he hit that towering home run or game-winning base hit? Now look no further than JT Sports, specializing in the sale and authentication of professional game-used bats. As the official authenticators of professional model game-used bats for PSA DNA, JT Sports will guarantee the authenticity of any bat purchased from them. JT Sports also buys and sells game-worn uniforms, gloves, and baseball equipment. The unique quality of the collectible is what JT Sports is all about. Give them a call at 609-487-8003 or check them out at GameUseBats.com. Hi, everyone. I'm Rico Petroselli, and I'm very excited to talk to you about our new partner, Panini America. Panini America is the world leader in licensed sports and entertainment collectibles, and we're proud to have them as the official trading card of the Great American Collectibles Show. When it comes to modern trading cards of your favorite players, Panini America leads the way in terms of innovation, design, creativity, value, and fun. From landmark brands such as Donruss, Prism, and Contenders, to high-end juggernauts like Flawless, National Treasures, and Immaculate, Panini America delivers the hottest trading cards of the biggest names in the NBA, NFL, MLBPA, NASCAR, soccer, and college. When you want to collect the best, collect Panini America. Ask for it at your local hobby shop or at mass retailers like Target and Walmart. And you can always find Panini America online at iCollectPanini.com. Panini America, who do you collect?
You know, when I hear that, Buddha, when I hear that music coming back, I feel like I want to jiggle. You know what I'm saying, bro?
Jeez. There is no jiggling.
There's no jiggling?
No jiggling.
Good music.
No.
Jiggling. All right, listen to the Great American Collectible Show. Tom Zappler, my pal, Red Sox Hall of Famer, Rico Petroselli. Behind the glasses, our new producer who we love, Mark LeMay, a.k.a. Buddha. If you look at him, you know why his nickname is Buddha. And before we get back to John, how about, do we have a little eBay music, Mr. LeMay?
Oh.
Okay, you're fine, $25. Here we go. Come on, Rico, let's go. A little, get into the eBay action.
Yeah, I am, I am. I love eBay. You kidding me?
I'm sorry, say that again.
That means I owe you $25.
That's right.
You said you like the music. Well, listen.
All right, go ahead, Rico.
All right, I want to talk. Yes, that's right. I do want to talk about eBay, right? If you're looking for autographed memorabilia, hard-to-find collectibles from your favorite team, that officially licensed MLB jersey, or those Jimmy G, Tom Brady Super Bowl tickets, jump on eBay right now. Now, why would they be, if they were, they're listening, well, of course they want to find some stuff, right, from eBay.
Fishing rods.
Yeah. You can find just about anything on eBay. If you're on a budget, you can purchase PSA graded cards at very affordable prices, by the way. Great pieces of memorabilia from your favorite dealers and players, autographs, and much more.
From everything to graded and ungraded T206 cards, Gaudis, Playball, and 52 Tops, there are some amazing, I repeat, amazing deals for anyone. As a matter of fact, if you find a game-used bat,
yeah,
buy the bat. Send it to JT Sports, to John Taube. He will authenticate it for you, or else he'll break your heart by telling you it's a fake.
Well, listen, you want to know.
And you know something? And don't forget, they have non-sports cards on eBay, Rico.
Did
you know that? Gilligan's Island,
yeah, tell you.
The Monkees.
All of those great
things. Davy Crockett, King of the Wild Frontier.
Yeah, right. Tarzan.
Tarzan, right?
Yep. Well, you know, they
and
have
even tickets to your favorite game.
You're kidding.
No.
Okay, wow. eBay has 162 million users. And don't worry, you'll get through. So, you know. And is the biggest and best marketplace in the world. Go to eBay.com and either make your purchase or get your bid in. I want to say, or get the hell out.
That's right. That's fine.
No, get your bid in.
All right.
We love you.
All right. By the way, before we get back to John, Eddie Fisher, the winner, make sure you message us your address
so we can get these. Remember that?
Yeah, Eddie Fisher.
I wish you
would. John, anyway. So when I was a kid, 8 years old,
that was a long time ago.
My wiffle ball team, we won the Greater Merrimack Valley Wiffle Ball Tournament, and I still have the bat. If I signed that bat, is there any value to it at all?
Excuse me?
I think he's been drinking too many martinis.
I guess that means no. John, go ahead. What were you going to say?
No, if you send that in, that would be fake.
It would be fake. Hey, listen, why are Yankee bats, and I could be wrong here, but they seem to be the most popular. I went on your website. You know, you got stuff by Cleet Boyer, Hector Lopez, some commons. Why are Yankee bats so popular, gamers?
Well, look, you know, the Yankees are the Yankees, okay? The championships, the great players, our location here on the East Coast. I don't want to, stretch my luck, but, is it America's team? I think at one time it was. And there's just, you see it when the Yankees are on the road, the number of Yankee fans that are in the stands. And it's just, it's the most popular team.
Yeah.
And when they, in our business, you know, the people who deal in team use, when the Yankees win, it's good for business.
Yeah. I mean, they 27 World Championships, and the Mystique also playing in New York, biggest market in the country. And so, let's face it, when they're good and the Red Sox are good as far as the American League is concerned, now you have a lot of interest.
And in baseball.
It's a great rivalry.
So, of the Yankee bats, John, give me the, in order, from 1 to 5, one being the most most popular, obviously, that's the Ruth bat. From 1 to 5, what are the 5 most popular player bats?
1 to 5. We'll go with Ruth, number 1.
Yeah.
Some of the listeners may argue, but I'm going to put Mantle, number 2.
Okay, that's fair.
No, Gehrig, huh?
Gehrig, 3?
Gehrig, number 3.
Yeah.
Number 4,
DiMaggio.
Joe D. Yeah, we'll go with Joe D. And then number 5. Who do you think, Rico?
Yogi Berra.
Yogi Berra, you're exactly right.
Yeah,
that would be the top 5.
Okay, I would buy those. I would buy all 5.
As far as the vintage guys are concerned. And now, obviously Derek Jeter with the more contemporary stuff.
Yeah.
Reggie's bats from late 70s. Very popular. Thurman Munson. And like Clemente has a cult following.
Yeah, yeah.
And those are going to be more meaningful, John, right? I mean, to Yankee fans, Yankee collectors. I mean, right? I would think even more so than somebody who's, a White Sox fan, let's say. Who's a collector?
One of our viewers is asking: Is a Maris gamer signed?
That's a good. Yeah, that's right.
That's got some value too, right?
Oh yeah. Everybody, obviously the Maris bats that have the most value, date right to the early '60s, where you can place it. If you can place one right to 61, that's the most desirable. It's funny, Roger. His early 60s bats, you see a lot of pine tar.
Yeah.
And then he moves over to the Cardinals, and the pine tar, vanishes, and he goes to a tape application.
Interesting.
Yep, spiral tape on the handle. A lot of the Cardinals use that. It must have been something the club equipment manager was doing.
Very
Shannon
interesting.
Shannon had tape, Cepeda, Maris, all the same type.
John, what about... Is there still, I know there are fines, quote, fines every day with cards and some memorabilia. Are there still some possible fines out there for pre-war bats, guys like Cobb,
or even Ruth, or you know, guys like Nap Lajoie, or even Jimmy Fox. Are there still bats you think that are out there that have not come out yet?
Well, you know, when you get back into, you know, the Lajoie era, you know, there's a good possibility somebody may have one of those laying in an attic or, you know, with a family member or something like that, and they don't even know it because it's probably a blank-barreled bat with no player name on it.
Right.
You know, the nicest Lajoie in the hobby, there's two bats that were returned by Lajoie to Louisville Slugger, and they're factory side-written on the side when the date that they were received and the player name is on them in pencil. Grease pencil.
Wow.
But other than that, you know, it's a blank barrel bat, you know, so you're not going to know who it was.
Who belonged to. One of our viewers is asking about the George Brett Pine Tar bat. Where is that bat now? What is a bat like that worth? I know it's an infamous bat, famous. There's a story behind it. Do you know where that bat is now? Is there a private collector? Is it in the Hall of Fame? Where is that bat?
I believe that bat is in the Hall of Fame.
Okay.
There was a bat that was, you know, sold publicly about 20-25 years ago during the Halper collection.
Sure.
That was attributed to the event, but it was, unfortunately, that bat was manufactured several years after the event. It was manufactured prior to the event, the one that was actually auctioned.
So that doesn't work.
Yeah, but I believe that bat did finally make its way to the Hall of Fame.
Really?
Here's something. John, I don't understand this. I'm sure you can explain it. The 600 home run guys, Tommy, Griffey Jr., Pujols, Mays, is that it? Well, anyway...
A-Rod.
A-Rod. I mean, A-Rod. What about these?
A-Rod.
Oh, God. Look, come on. He still hit 600
come
plus
on, 300
home
run. Of them.
You still got to hit the ball. Anyway, that's your... So, I mean, what are these bats, I would think, you know, would be worth a ton of money.
Well, all the players that you named, the most popular guy there, you know, obviously, you know, did we mention Willie Mays?
Yes.
Mays.
I mentioned him.
Yeah, Mays is number one.
Yeah, oh, sure.
And then you've got, you know, Griffey Jr. is right there. Tommy is a popular guy, but his bats are climbing right now. They're, you know, a real nice one is a bargain as far as I'm concerned, about $2,500. Oh. A nice Tommy bat. And A-Rod is picking up steam because, you know, the problems that he had really diminished the value of his material that was out there.
Yeah.
See, I told you.
And now with, I don't know if you want to call it the J-Lo effect or the, you know, what he's doing with.
That's a good way to put it, the J-Lo effect.
No, he's doing well, you know, with MLB and Fox the work he's doing on TV. He's very likable. He's very knowledgeable.
Yes.
You know, he's doing a great job, and his prices are starting to go back up again.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. Very, very interesting. Find that whole thing. I can't wrap my arms around it. I'm sorry, guys. Both of you.
No, I hear you.
Sorry. Rico, your bat collection. Do you have any of your gamers at home?
Yes, I have a couple.
How many do you have? A couple?
Two or four, something like that.
And your 40th is in the
Hall of Fame. Yeah.
And they own it, or do you own
it?
No,
they own it. I don't want it.
Why don't you want it?
No, I'm just kidding. It's a piece of wood. What do you want?
No, did you get
it? I got the ball.
So you have the 40th home run ball. But today, did the Red Sox give them the bat, or did you?
I did.
You gave it to them, or did you loan it to them?
No, I gave it to... Well, I signed, probably gave it, but... think about it. After the year was over, you know... one of the guys, it might have been the president, too. I think he was from Boston, you know, said, would you give the bat to Hall of Fame? I mean, think about it. It's a thrill. I mean, you got something
on
the Hall
of Fame. I'm agreeing with
but
you.
But that's why I said, that might be there a long time, and, you know, it'd be nice.
So, John, does a bat like that have any type, you know, I'm sure it has some value. I mean.
Absolutely. The actual bat you hit the 40th home run with.
Right.
Yes. Yep.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, with Red Sox fans, that's a very desirable bat.
Yeah.
Oh. Very desirable bat. And I'm sure, you know, it would go, that's definitely an auction bat.
Mm-hmm. Really?
And I'll bet you, you know, that it's going to garner several thousand dollars.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's nice, you know, but...
Can I have the ball?
No.
Please?
I got the
ball. Is that still a record for Red Sox shortstop?
For Red Sox shortstop,
yeah,
it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know who broke the record?
Soon to be broken by... Bogarts.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Yeah, kid's good.
You know who broke Rico's record, right?
Yeah. Hey, Rod.
Right.
Thank you.
But...
Oh, yeah, but I'm saying team record for the Red Sox.
Yeah, right, Rico still holds it, I think that's going to be broken pretty soon. Xander Bogaerts is...
He's a good player.
He's a good player. Yeah.
But anyway...
John, I like
that. No, I mean, you got... Do people, I would think, collect... They want to collect all 600 home run guys or all 500 home run guys,
sure.
Stuff like that, right?
Yeah, that's still one of the major... collectible areas, you know, of the hobby. You know, the 500, 600 home run club.
Oh, yeah. That would be nice.
700 home run club. You know, those are the guys. People associated game-used bats with hitters.
John, you know, I noticed, and I was talking to actually Joe Orlando about it, too. I know that you restore and repair bats. Question is, if I have a bat, if I have a Rico Petrocelli game-used bat, 1967 World Series, it's got this big freaking crack down the middle of it, am I better off not having John Taube repair it? I mean, when you repair a bat, doesn't that decrease the value of the bat?
Well, no, it does not decrease the value. In most cases, it's going to increase the value. The market has dictated the preference for uncracked material or slightly cracked material. And a lot of bat collectors, you know, one of the, you know, the enjoyment that people get from, you know, collecting bats is taking them off the wall, picking them up, swinging them, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, so that's one of the reasons people get them repaired. I tell collectors it's a very personal decision.
Right.
It's up to the collector. You know, and I understand totally if you want to preserve the essence of the bat as it came off the field. You know, that's another way of looking at it. What we've done is we've done letters for bats that have been in two pieces. You know, we did a letter on the Piazza piece.
Right.
From the, the Mets, the Yankee World Series. You remember the Roger Clemens game when the bat flew in three pieces?
Yeah.
We authenticated a piece of that.
Nice.
You know, a couple of bats come to mind of Derek Jeter's that were broken in two.
Wait, when you are...
You know, they'll leave them just the way they are.
Really?
Yeah, that's something.
Sure.
When
but
you...
grading, you know, under the grading scale, and again, the way the collector market has evolved, the repair of a restoration of a handle, a bad crack in the handle is going to generally bump up the bat a little in value.
Interesting.
Yeah, when you authenticate a bat, do you have to find out the age of the wood? Is that part of it?
Well, no, we don't do that, but the labeling that is on the bat itself.
Yeah.
Arrow brands, the center brand, the player name up on the end of the barrel.
Back into it.
And we've robbed all of that information.
No.
And we've actually, we've set up a database of branding from, let's go back into the late 1800s, 1890, 1895 to the present day.
Interesting. Very interesting.
It is something.
Hey, John, before we let you go, I have one more. I know that you've authenticated a lot of bats, and you've probably broken a lot of bad news to a lot of people. What is the... Is there one bat that was fake that sticks out in your mind that you had to go to a collector and say, I'm really sorry, but this bat is a fake?
George Brett.
Really?
The Pine Tar bat, yeah.
Wow.
Well, recent bats, you know, that's been a problem. Past, and I mean over the past you know, 15, 20 years, I would say that is the most frequent problem that we run into.
Wow.
People, you know, apparently Brett, there was a lot of game bats of Brett's that appear to have been signed by him in mint condition.
Right.
And then people, you know, they play with them. They
sure.
take them, they pick them up. Suddenly there's a lot of tar on them, et cetera, et cetera. And they get sent in, and, you know, at times, you know, we have to be the bearer of bad news.
That is not good. His name is John Taube, JT Sports. If anybody has anything to do with bats, if you have a bat, you own a bat, you want to buy a bat, you want to go to jtsports.com, John, right? Whatever.
Game used bats.
I was close.
Yeah.
Game used bats. John, you can talk to John, ask him questions. Mr. Taube, it's been a pleasure. You know how much we love having you. You bring so much to the table, and we always get great, great comments, John. With that being said, brother, we love you, and we'll talk to you down the road.
Always fun. Thank you, guys.
All right, John Taube. All right, we're going to take a quick break. We come back. We're going to chat for a few minutes with REA Auctions' Brian Dwyer. Hang in. We'll be right back.
Hey, I'm Mike Petroselli. If your company is looking for the best in marketing and promotional items, you'll hit a home run with Petroselli Marketing. With over 8,000 suppliers and 650,000 imprint-ready items, we can get your company the visibility it needs to get your maximum exposure. Whether it be office promotions, wearables, automotive, sports items, and everything in between, Petroselli Marketing can do it all. Our design staff will even work with you from concept to delivery and customize your products. At Petroselli Marketing Group, we will get your brand in front of your audience. Contact us at info@petrocellimkt.com or call us at 603-880-3202. That's Petroselli Marketing, where no dream is impossible.
When it comes to meeting a budget, Pristine Auction has something for everyone. Jared and his staff at Pristine offer several auction formats, all the way down to a daily auction. Each auction ends nightly with hundreds of lots, and by the way, all daily auctions are offered with no reserve prices. Whether it's cards, signed jerseys, sports, or non-sports memorabilia, Pristine has it all. Pristine Auction is also proud to partner with Hope Sports in Mexico. Our mission is to help those in need. That's Pristine Auction, P-R-I-S-T-I-N-E. Simply go to pristineauction.com and begin bidding. And don't forget, mention the guys from the Great American Collectibles Show. That's Pristine Auction, meeting your collectible needs.
Mint State is a PSA-authorized dealer specializing in high-grade vintage sports and non-sport cards. Established in 2002 and in its 18th year of full-time operation, we utilize an extensive network of sellers, collectors, and other dealers for the millions of dollars in collectibles we sell every year. Mint State has assisted with many of the finest collections ever assembled and offers sellers, such as the owners of the Lucky 7 Find, an attractive consignment package in addition to outright purchase. For more information, please visit mintstateinc.com or contact Rick Snyder by email at mintstate@msn.com or by telephone at 630-365-9790. Happy hunting!
Big things are happening at Small Traditions. The Denver-based auction firm has moved into new digs in the Cherry Creek North Business District of Denver, just one block from the world-famous Cherry Cricket. Small Traditions' cost-free grading promotion is also growing. Now submit up to 500 cards for consideration for grading and don't pay a penny out of pocket. Let owner Dave Thorne and the experts at Small Traditions do all of the work for you and enjoy a 0% seller's fee as well. New headquarters, a new website, a new hard closing procedure to its premium auctions, new block sites like KofaxCards.com and JeterCards.com and more. Small Traditions has also teamed with PSA to sponsor its monthly Madness Sweepstakes. Enter today at PSAcard.com for your chance to win prizes valued as high as $2,000. Go to smalltraditions.com for more info. That's Small Traditions, where big things are happening.
Listen, before we get to, you know something, we should film what goes on between during the commercial breaks. Before we get to our good friend, Brian Dwyer from REA Auctions, let's talk about our good friends at Panini, the 2019-20 Panini Absolute Basketball Preview. Set to release the day before Thanksgiving 2019 and 20, Panini Absolute Basketball will offer another chance to snare some early Zion Williamson rookie cards that picture him in his NBA uniform. This season's edition of Absolute will offer two packs per box with five cards per pack and 10 boxes per case. Each box should have two autographs and two memorabilia cards on average. Look for these new base card format this year featuring veterans as well as top rookies. All kinds of really, really, really neat stuff. And Panini. Panini is just, the stuff they're doing is incredible. Yeah, yeah. For more information, go to our friends at PaniniAmerica.net.
All these organizations and the auction houses, all the guys we have on,
they're all good guys.
All good. They're companies.
You know what we did, though?
The companies are outstanding.
I know Brian's probably listening to this. Is Brian with us? Hey, Brian, how you doing, kid?
Hey, good. How are you?
Good. You know what the thing is, Rick? All kidding aside, we did, at the very beginning of the show, you and I talked about this, and we made a solid in agreement to only bring the quality auction houses. You know what I mean?
I know what you mean. We're not blowing you because we want to have good people on. The quality guys. They know what they're doing. They know their stuff.
All right, let's get to our friend Brian Dwyer from REA Auction. Brian, first of all, let's talk. We've got about five, six minutes. Let's talk about how successful was your past auction, number one.
Oh, great, great success. First time we've done an auction over the summer. We decided to put one together around the National this year. And so it was about 2,900 lots, did just shy of $8 million, chock full of some great PSA stuff, record-breaking prices. So we're very happy.
Now, you have a fall auction starting on the 20th of November?
Yep, it's about 5 weeks away, November 20th, and it'll close on December 8th.
Okay, so let's talk about that. Can you share any of the little tidbits you've picked up so far?
I have a before you ask, if it's okay, Tom.
Go ahead.
How do you get the items?
Good, that's a good question, Mika. It's about time you asked a good question.
Yeah, well, it's just...
Yeah, so we get items from all parts of the collecting and non-collecting world. Okay. So we have a lot of consigners that are collectors that are downsizing or switching out of stuff, upgrading, downgrading, selling off their lifelong collections. And then we have a fair number of consigners that are out of the hobby. They've discovered something. Mm-hmm. We just picked up in the Boston area not too long ago a group of 150 old judges from the 19th century.
Wow.
We just got in 10 cabinet cards from Chicago the other day. So stuff is buried out there in attics and basements and barns around the country. So it's a mix of collectors and non-collectors, but it comes from everywhere.
Brian, like you mentioned Boston. Now, did you personally come out to pick it up, or did you have one of your people that works for you?
Yeah, one of the guys in my office went up there and met with the consigner and his father, a family who found the cards. We educated them on what they had, put together a deal, and they'll all be in the upcoming auction.
Because if you're ever in Boston and you don't contact us to let us know that you're here, we will track you down.
I will. You're my first phone call.
No, I'm serious. We'd love to have, give us a call, and the three of us will get together, grab a bite on Rico's tab.
I was just going to say on you.
Why do I have to pay?
Because... You're a wealthy man.
Okay.
I'll come up there and show you some of the highlights. We've got a real good Boston representation this
Well, if you ever do, man, you come into the studio with us, we'll do the entire show with you in the studio. But can you share some of the tidbits, some of the items for the fall auction, or is it too early?
No, we've got plenty of highlights. So we've got leading off the auction a Cobb from the Lucky 7 find. So that'll be nice. It's a beautiful 1.5 that came from that big find of a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
We have several high-grade Ruth cards. We have a new-to-the-hobby signed Gaudi Babe Ruth that we just got back from PSA as a 9. That'll be very exciting. We have a Garrick.
Hold on. Did you say it was signed?
Nine.
Signed.
Wow.
Signed. Signed. Oh, and graded a 9. line. Yep.
Wow. But, you know, I know there was a good friend of ours. I can't mention his name. I know there was Brian, and I know you guys are all friends, Brian Drentz. He had three Ruth cards, and a good friend of ours bought one of them, paid quite a lot of money for them. Did you see those cards?
Oh, yeah, they were beautiful.
Weren't they cool? They really were.
They were very nice.
Yeah.
Yep. And they went for strong money. Like
I know
the
they did,
so
really.
It bodes well for the one that we have. And we also have a signed Gehrig from the same collection.
Wow.
So very, very exciting there. And then I mentioned the Boston highlights. We have a 1950 Ted Williams complete uniform. We have a Ted Williams game-used bat. We have a 1939 play ball Ted Williams rookie card in a 9.
Jeez.
We have a Ted Williams game-used glove. 57 Mantle all-star game-used bat. We have a Hank Aaron uniform. So some big, big power
great
coming
stuff.
Out. Close
power
out
isn't
here.
The word. You're talk about heavy lumber. My God.
That is great
so,
stuff.
Brian, you know, it's interesting that the auction goes from November 20th to December 8th. Now, after this auction is over, do you kind of break down the tent until the spring?
We're never not working.
Okay.
There's always stuff coming in. There's always, you know, it's impossible to put together the auctions of the size and caliber that we do in just a short couple-week period. So it takes us every bit of the 3 or 4 months before the next one to get stuff ready and get everything photographed. We, you know, we put out that 700-page catalog. So it's a lot of moving parts. We're always doing something.
You know, a couple of weeks ago, we had this guy, man, talk about someone that spoke glowingly of you. We had Lee Behrens on.
Oh, okay.
And, you know, Lee's a one-man operation, seems like a real nice guy, hard worker. He couldn't say enough about you, enough good things. So just wanted
to... Yeah,
now
Lee and I have known each other a number of years. He's doing great things with Sterling, which obviously I founded, you know, almost a decade ago now.
Sure.
So, no, he's done great. I'm happy to see him succeed.
All right, so people want to consign, people want to buy. Can you give us the website address?
Yeah, the best thing to do is go to robertedwardauctions.com. We've got 3 auctions coming up next year. We've got, obviously, this fall auction for bidders coming up in 5 weeks. And lots to see, lots to do with REA.
Brian, you've done a great job. You're one of the guys that the other guys talk about, you know, the competition.
It's solid,
because
man, a great organization.
Yeah, and you're a young guy. You get it. You understand it. And you've given the industry a good name. So congratulations. And we'll talk to you down the road.
Yeah.
All right, appreciate it. Thanks,
Brian.
Guys.
Take care. Brian Dwyer from REA Auctions.
Yeah, that's great.
Speaking of auctions, Rico, what about our friends at RR? One of our new sponsors is RR Auctions. Do you know what the RR stands for, Rico?
Of course I do. You know that. Come on. It stands for Remarkable Results.
Can you say that again?
Remarkable Results. The memorabilia that RR Auctions has is really remarkable.
You know that the items in their fall auction, they were absolutely tremendous.
Yeah, you're not kidding. Here are a few examples. Sold.
Here we go. Come on, we got like 2.5 minutes.
Sounds like it's phony, right?
Go ahead.
Hey, we wrote it down here. All right. You're not kidding. Here are a few examples. What? Space exploration memorabilia from the Apollo and Gemini programs. Wow. Full letters and notes signed by Ty Cobb and Cy Young.
Former teammates of yours.
Yeah, that's right. How about Wild West memorabilia signed by Geronimo and Sting?
It's true. It's true. And don't you think when the time comes, RR should auction off some of your stuff, Rico?
Well, maybe the game-worn jersey with pizza stain on it. Or that White House cigar stub I left over from the 67 clincher. You think it's worth anything, Tom?
No.
Anyway, call 603-732-4280 and ask for the consignment department.
That's RR Auctions, our good friends, Bob Eaton, Bobby Livingston. We love those guys. Go to rrauctions.com. Hey, Buddha, you know something, man? We love having you. You get it. You understand it. We're having fun with you. And you don't know a damn thing about memorabilia business, but we're going to teach you.
That's all right.
We're going to teach you.
I know everything about it because I pay how many bike spokes
right.
I poked with baseball cards when I was a kid.
We're going to get
Thurman
you.
Thurman Munson.
Right. We're going to get you into something good to start collecting. How about a 19, start collecting a 1984 Topps set. gold. It's worth gold.
How many in the set?
I don't know, but it's worth nothing.
Joanne, hi, sweetheart.
All right, listen. I think we're...
You got a minute.
Good to see
you.
We got a minute. Good.
Good to talk.
Listen, real quickly, Fellowship of Christian Athletes doing great. Congratulations.
Yeah, right. That's involved with the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, a big organization worldwide.
And that's why you're only here every other week. Number two, you're doing a lot of Red Sox stuff?
Some Red Sox stuff, yeah. That'd be great. And,
and for our viewers that are in the Boston area, Rico and I and Mark and Johnny Malure, you're going to be at the Wilmington show in November on that Saturday, the first weekend. November. We're going to be meeting some people. Rico is going to be at the Memory Lane booth. No signing, meet and greet. Yes. With that being said, Buddha, we love you. Rico, we love you.
Hey, it was great. Great show. Tom, keep up the good work. Buddha, nice job, buddy.
And to our followers and listeners, happy collecting. Thank you.